You found a place to belong here in the Circle of Friends. I'm Missy, and I have my good friend Amy with me. Hey, Amy.
Hello.
It's so good to have you back.
It's good to be here.
I'm so thankful because one of the favorite things that you like to talk about, I like to talk about, but you are a student of the Word. And I think the last time you were here, and we said we'd have you back and you were going to do more of this, but we talked about apologetics. Now, when I first heard that word, I don't know about you, Amy, but the first time I heard that word in the Christian realm, I thought, whoa, what do you mean apologize? I'm not apologizing. We don't apologize for Christ. What are you talking about? Like, it kind of ruffled my feathers just a little bit.
Right.
But that's not at all what we're talking about.
No.
We're not. So maybe the first thing we can do is give a definition for apologetics and what that means.
Okay. Well, you know, you're not alone in that. A lot of people, when they hear the word apologetics, do think of it as a form of apologizing for our faith. And that's at all not what we're talking about. Apologetics is more of a case for what you believe, mm-hmm. a rational reason for what you believe. It comes from the word apologia, which is Greek, which is a speech or a defense. And it's used 8 times in the New Testament.
Wow.
Specifically, the verse from Peter. I think we talked about this last time. Oh, yeah. 1 Peter 3:15. We talked about that last time. Always be prepared to give an answer. And the word is apologia there to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. And I remember years ago, I was a young mom. I mean, this was many years ago. I remember having the Bible on my front seat as I went through a gas station, and it was full service, which
was even nobody knows what that anymore. What's full service?
It was even unusual for those times, but I have some health issues. So when I often went to this gas station, and the guy who was helping me looked at the Bible in my seat. He's like, "So you believe that's true?" And I'm like, "Yeah." And he goes, "Why? Why, you know, why do you believe that's true?" And I remember stumbling over my words, blah, blah, blah. And I hadn't thought it out.
Yeah.
I didn't have a concise answer. And before I pulled away, it was obvious at that point he was a Christian. He goes, you need to be able to defend that. And then he quoted that verse to me. And I remember pulling away thinking, know, kind of like a failure. But also my eyes opened up to, oh, he's right. That is a command.
Yeah.
When someone asks, we need to be prepared. And he was asking.
Well, and honestly, if you ask for opportunity, God will give it. So are you ready?
Oh, absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? And not only that, I don't even believe that you have to ask God for opportunity. I think the opportunities are there.
Right.
The thing is asking God for you to see the opportunities, mm-hmm. because we
That's
see people
point.
Every day. We have mm-hmm. interactions with people every day. There's often a door or an opening for conversation that we totally miss, like mm-hmm. just boom, go right by mm-hmm. it. And that has become even more apparent to me as I spend more and more time with my husband, who is so good about this. You know, he starts a conversation. I'm much more reserved. Like, I don't mind talking to strangers, but I'm not going to walk right up. You know, they have to sort of open the door for me to do that. Do you know what I'm saying?
Right, yeah.
That's a little bit more my personality. So I have to pray for more mm-hmm. boldness to be able to be willing to make that first step. But people, not everybody, mm-hmm. but in general, people are willing and want to talk. You mm-hmm. know what I'm saying? They
want to
they want to engage, especially if you approach it in a way of a conversation, mm-hmm. which I think in today's world is a lost art, especially face to face.
And people are thinking about spirituality a lot. I mean, people have right now more than ever, I think, people feel or say they're spiritual or feel spiritual or questioning spirituality. And so I feel like it's a time more than ever that we need to look for those conversations and be open to those conversations.
Yes.
Actually, I've been asked to facilitate or lead a study called Why Do People Believe That? And it actually talks about what you just said there, looking for opportunities or even creating opportunities mm-hmm. to discuss these kind of matters, this type of heavier matter by genuinely listening to somebody, mm-hmm. but then gently guiding the conversation to important issues. And I do think people are open to that. People mm-hmm. want to talk about spiritual things.
One of the things, just even recently, my husband Ned preached a sermon on this, and he gave such examples that when you think of it, you think, oh my goodness, that, yes, you're right. That was a perfect opportunity where the door is open for, and it may not be a time to give, you know, the four spiritual laws, and right. you pray with me right now, but it is an opportunity to plant a seed. And so yeah. if you listen to people and you ask the right questions and listen to their response,
right.
it may give you an opportunity to share what you believe.
Right.
You can't use a battering ram. That does
right.
not work. What you have to have is a dialogue. That is, me asking a question, they saying something, me listening to what they're saying.
Yeah.
Or as you're talking, listening to what they're saying and ask a question mm-hmm. about what they're saying. And hopefully a door opens. And mm-hmm. then you just let the conversation go from there. But if you're prepared, it's like, and I'm going to use my husband as an example again, but he is on the road all the time, and he tows vehicles, or he transports vehicles, and he has a tow car. And in his tow car, oh my goodness, I won't even ride in it. It is such a junk piece. But it makes him money. And the reason it makes him money is he has everything you can imagine that you would need on the road. I mean, everything.
Yeah.
We went on vacation several months ago, and we were pulling a boat. The trailer got a flat tire,
mm-hmm.
and he was pulling it. No problem. He pulls over. He has everything he needs to change this tire. I mean, there were a couple of complications with it, but he had yeah. everything he needed. Why? Because he just doesn't go on the road without everything you can possibly think of.
Yeah.
Especially when he's towing his tow car, and he's got a vehicle. So, he gets to a place and he goes to put on a hitch. That's not the right kind of hitch. So he has all this metal and towing equipment I don't even know how he puts this stuff together, but do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's a good analogy. He's
so
prepared.
When we think yeah. about that, be prepared. Have these tools in
yeah.
your toolbox.
Yeah.
Do a study like this one.
Yeah.
Why do they believe that by yeah. Mary Jo Sharp?
Yeah.
Or at least get it set in your mind how you might answer that question.
Right.
If somebody says, do you believe why do you believe the Bible? That's not true.
Right.
What do you say to
right.
that?
Right.
And it is a little scary. I have to admit, I can understand that but again, if you're put on the spot and you don't have an answer, that's a lot harder.
Right. And that the point of the study is twofold. One is training to learn the skills to be a good conversationalist
mm.
and a good listener. And the other is just learning information to effectively share and defend what we believe.
Mm-hmm.
And so even though that can be intimidating, there is information out there, and we don't have to be experts. You know, it goes a long way to be transparent. Just be like, that's a good question. I don't know. Or share your own struggles with doubt or your own. For me, like I just said, share your own struggles with doubt. I go through bouts of doubt every once in a while, and I question, is it okay to doubt? But I'm in good company when I look back at people who have doubted before. Martin Luther, C.S. Lewis, Charles Spurgeon. And so, yes, I believe it's okay to doubt. And that's something effective for me personally when I'm talking to people who have questions.
Yeah.
So using your own experience, not having to have the answers,
yes.
But be willing to listen and willing to say, well, let's look into that. Or I've struggled with that too. If we're really listening to them, those are the kind of conversations people want to have.
Yeah.
Not that we waiting for the opportunity to give them all the answers, but really listening to what they believe
yeah.
and their struggle. It's a conversation. So that's what this study does. It makes us better at conversations, and then also provides information.
Yeah. And I think there's a key here, and that is we can always share passionately and confidently about our own experience, because it's ours.
Right.
What happened in my life, what I've seen God do for me, what I've experienced, all those things are mine. And nobody can
mm-hmm.
tell me that that's not true, because I've experienced it. You may not believe me, and that's okay.
Right.
But I can speak from a standpoint of confidence when I talk about you know, well, this is why I trusted Christ, or this mm-hmm. is, these are mm-hmm. the ways I've seen God work in my life. This is what I've noticed about the Bible, or this is what I found out about the Bible. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like when you talk in terms, and rather than trying to tell someone else what they should believe, or what, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And that's the difference. And I'm not saying you can't speak authoritatively about the Word of God. And if you have mm-hmm. some wisdom about Greek and Hebrew, and you are a student of apologetics, that you can't speak confidently that way. But I'm sharing this to encourage people who are like, I don't mm-hmm. know what to say. Mm-hmm. You can always share your experience. If you right. know Christ, you have experience with him in some way, shape, or form. Mm-hmm. You've gone through a process to get into a relationship with him. How did that happen? Well, you can easily. I mean, really, if you, it's easy to tell someone your testimony of what happened mm-hmm. because it happened to you. So it's not like you have to know these great, mighty wisdom. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It's just a personal experience that you can share. And whether or not it comes to that, you can certainly share from your viewpoint in a way that is non-threatening to someone else.
Right.
Because you're not, I've seen people try this and they push at people rather than having a conversation mm-hmm. that offers them something. So offer a piece of yourself, as you said, transparency, and say, you know, that is a really good question, because mm-hmm. I felt that way too. But you know what? In the end, I always come back to the Word of God.
Yes. And
this is, you know, this mm-hmm. is my process, how I do that. Mm-hmm. Or that's a really good question. You know what? I'm gonna start reading about that and see if I can find some answers. Mm-hmm. Because I'd like to know that too. I mean, that is non-threatening.
Right.
Keeps the conversation going. Keeps mm-hmm. it open. Maybe opens the door for another conversation mm-hmm. at another time. If it's someone you know, you can mm-hmm. get back together and say, oh, I looked that mm-hmm. up. This is what this guy
right.
said. What do you think about that?
Right.
How does that strike you? Yeah. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah.
I mean, it's... It's just so different than trying to say, you know, if you died today, do you know you'd go to heaven?
Right.
Which is a great question. Don't get me wrong. But, you know, it's like, do this, and this. We have to quit trying. And I see this in social media all the time. We have to quit trying to tell people what they think and how they feel.
Right. Right.
Or make assumptions. If you're this, then you're this. Well, that's mm-hmm. not necessarily true. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's only one way to be a Christian, and that is through Jesus Christ alone. Now, if somebody has a different viewpoint, there's a way to share what you believe without mm-hmm. beating down another person, right?
Mm-hmm. And often you can get there by asking questions. Why do you believe that?
Yeah.
And get them talking about why they believe that. Because sometimes I think in apologetics, we can jump into, like, someone's an atheist. They don't believe in God. You can assume why they don't believe in God and then have all these arguments prepared for, evidence or an apologetic for God, but that might not be what they're questioning at all.
Yeah.
So you have to find out what they're questioning yeah. before you can go there.
Yeah.
And I do find, like you said, sharing a piece of yourself is so effective. And I know when I first struggled with, really had my first crisis of faith, it was so hard. And like I said, I even questioned if I was a believer what I was questioning at the time was scripture, if it was authoritative. And then that was kind of like a slippery slope into doubting other things. And it was a struggle, but God uses our struggle to speak to other people.
Absolutely.
And the thing that made me go down that road of really analyzing what I believed is because I was asked to be a Young Life leader when I was in college. Young Life was so impactful to me in high school. And so when I was asked to be a leader, I hated to say no, but I was struggling, you know? And so it made me really dig in deep to what I believe and why I believe. But then God used that because I remember when I went to camp with all these high schoolers, I connected with other kids who struggle.
Yeah.
Cause I'm like, you know what? That I had problems with that too.
Yeah.
But here's where I landed on that. And God always, it's true. God always, always brings me out of these times of doubt with a stronger faith in him, much stronger faith in him. So I could share with them the books I read mm-hmm. or whatever. So God uses our struggles. And for other people, it might not be struggling with doubt. It can be anything.
Mm-hmm.
But God absolutely uses our struggles. Nothing is wasted to connect with other people.
Oh, that is awesome. This is a fascinating conversation we're having with Amy on apologetics. And we're going to continue that in just a moment after we take a little break. Thanks for joining us today here on the Circle of Friends.
Want in on a little secret? The boutique at Village Gift Barn is a big city boutique in the heart of Amish country. Surprised? Most people are. Our beautifully diverse women's boutique carries regular and plus sizes and has something for every woman, no matter what her personal style. We carry everything from unique pieces you won't find anywhere else to the brands you know and love, like Brighton, Pandora, and Vera Bradley. Stop by and let our friendly, knowledgeable ladies help you create a look that's all your own. Village Gift Barn is located in the heart of Amish country at 4755 State Route 39 in Berlin, Ohio.
Here in the Circle of Friends, you're with Missy and Amy. And Amy, right before the break, you brought up something which, and you've mentioned this before on another program that we've had with you, these crises of faith that you've had, this doubt that you've gone through. And I love that you're willing to share that, because I do believe that that can be actually an encouragement to others, because sometimes we can feel like we're all alone in this, mm-hmm. you know, whatever it is we're struggling with, whether mm-hmm. it's doubt or fear or, you know, you name it. There's a lot of struggles we go through. And if you know someone else has been through that same struggle, it's comforting to you. And it's also helpful to hear how you went through that process. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure that you've seen that in your own life where as you've shared that, you have doubt, then you've seen God work as you talk to someone else about it.
Right, right. And I can share the things that pulled me out of it. Well, first of all, I like to, when someone says they're struggling or even an atheist, you know, who's someone who doesn't even believe in God, I like to, if the conversation goes this way, I love to end it with what God says in Jeremiah 29:13. So many people are familiar with Jeremiah 29:11. Yeah. For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. But if you go a couple verses down, he says, and I love this so much, you will seek me and find me when you seek me with your whole heart. And then the next sentence is period. And then I will be found by you. Mm. So if we really genuinely seek with an open heart, God promises, I will be found by you. So in the times when I'm struggling, he honors that. If somebody's struggling with doubt, they're searching. They're actually searching for truth. And yes. Jesus is the truth.
Yes.
And so he says, when you search for me, I will be found by you.
Oh,
that's
awesome.
So comforting. So I can share that with other people, you know, how meaningful that verse was to me and how, honestly, just the idea that they're seeking, God will be found by them.
And you're not the only one to doubt. Obviously, you mentioned others that C.S. Lewis and I believe you mentioned Charles Spurgeon before the break.
Charles Spurgeon says, I think when a man says, I never doubt, it's time for us to doubt him.
Oh,
and
wow.
So, yeah.
Wow.
And
say that again.
He says, I think when a man says, I never doubt, it's time for us to doubt him.
Wow.
And so for me, it was so comforting that I wasn't alone in this. You know, great men that had great faith in God and were really effective and leading others also had times of doubt.
Exactly.
I know one time I was sharing, C.S. Lewis was impactful to me. I think before the break, I was sharing that my personal bout of doubt in college helped me minister to high school kids. And so many of them resonated with that. And then I bought them the books that were helpful to me. I had just gone through Evidence Demands a Verdict by Josh McDowell, and my favorite book, C.S. Lewis, Mere Christianity. And that's a book I have on hand. I have a few copies so I can give it to people.
Oh, that's great.
But when I, one time I was in a store talking to a young guy, he was agnostic, and he had questions. And I was sharing C.S. Lewis, Mere Christianity, with him. And somebody in the store overheard us and came over and said, you know, I didn't mean to be eavesdropping, but I did hear you talking about C.S. Lewis. He said a great book for a more modern apologetist is Tim Keller. You know, he wrote, I'm trying to think of the name. He wrote The Reason for God. And I remember being like, oh, so I went and looked up the book and bought a copy for myself and that young man, because he was, he worked there at the store. And then later I realized, oh my goodness, I already had a copy because I heard it on Moody Radio, but I hadn't read it yet. But something Tim Keller says, it really resonated with me. It's kind of a long quote. I think I'll read it.
Go for it.
A faith without some doubts is like a human body without any antibodies in it. People who blithely go through life too busy or indifferent to ask hard questions about why they believe as they do will find themselves defenseless against either the experience of tragedy or the probing questions of a skeptic. A person's faith can collapse almost overnight if she or he has failed over the years to listen to her doubts, which should only be discarded after a long reflection. Believers should acknowledge and wrestle with doubts, not only their own doubts, but that of their friends.
Wow.
And other skeptics that they've heard.
Wow. I love that. I love that. When you think about it, it makes so much sense, because we can spout things, but if there's no belief behind it, and you can find that out by asking questions of others or of yourself even, like, why do I think that? Where did that come from? And then if you realize that the source is not a good source, or if your thinking really isn't logical when you look at the whole picture about anything, and not just faith, but especially our faith, that wrestling with doubt, you're right. It strengthens our faith. It's
and
an
exercise. And I like how, you know, Tim Keller, he brings up, not only does it help us with questions of the probing skeptic, but the experience of tragedy. If we haven't really wrestled with our own doubt or looked into our faith and why we believe it, then when tragedy hits, it can crumble. And I think that's common. You know, that happens.
And tragedy may be one thing that kind of stresses or puts us into that doubting God through that. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of people do do struggle through tragedy. And you're right. If you're not prepared for it, it can be even harder to get through that because you're not only dealing with whatever whatever the tragedy is, if it's grief or loss or struggle or loss of a dream, a job, a relationship, a person. If you're not prepared to that point, then going through that is going to be even harder because then you don't have anything to cling to.
Right.
And I often hear Christians say, I don't know what I would do if I weren't a Christian. And I believe that's true because we know that we do have someone, something to hold on to. We have this truth that we know. And even when we wrestle, I feel like this is the mental picture I get. When I wrestle and think, oh God, what, why, what, how are you? Do you even hear me? When I picture myself doing that, it's like me like struggling and kicking like a little kid. And God has literally got me by the scruff of the neck and holding on to me. Like, okay, miss, kick all you want. You know, I've got a hold of you and it's going to be okay. You know what I mean? And then finally, when I settle down and I stop, he gently lets go of it. And then I'll turn around and we'll have a conversation with him. But that... You know what? You have to go through the process. You absolutely do. Because if you don't, then your faith, it doesn't go the deep roots that it needs to grow, you know?
Right. Josh McDowell, which I mentioned, wrote, "Evidence demands a verdict." Such an effective apologetist.
Lord, liar, lunatic.
I mean, and you know what? He was quoting C.S. Lewis when he said that.
Yes.
And we'll talk about that another day. You know, is Christ who he said he was? And Lord, liar, lunatic, which you just, Jesus is who he said he was, Lord. Or he's a liar, you know, knew he wasn't, or lunatic. He was crazy and believed it and it wasn't true. And so, Lord, lunatic, a liar, or liar. I love that line of reasoning. But anyways, Josh McDowell, who was an effective apologist, who had all the great arguments to defeat, you know, doubt and skeptics. His son, Sean, who heard all of these, grew up with all of these. When he was in college, he started to doubt. He had his own crisis of faith. And Josh said something along the lines, that's awesome, because you need to make it your own faith. As long as you, without a crisis of some sort, you're only believing your parents' faith. And so he looked at that as like, that's awesome. And Sean went on to become a doctor. I think he got his doctorate in both philosophy and theology. That's it. So I just love that. You know, it again, it's just another person testifying that doubt is fine. And like I said, my own my personal testimony is God always brings me out of it with such a stronger faith. So embrace that doubt, like struggle through it. The struggle will make you stronger. And then something that God can use to speak to somebody else's doubt.
You know, you bring up something interesting because as I think about this, as parents, we want our children to have faith and we do everything we can as they're young to teach them about faith. But I think sometimes what we miss as parents is that there's only so much we can do. They have to come to their own faith. Mm-hmm. And if we don't teach them that they have to come to their own faith and not have our faith, then it's going to be harder for them later on, I think, if they if they somehow miss that connection. And everybody's on their own journey. So it might be there are kids that grow up in a Christian home that never waver from that. They remain a Christian, never struggle with that. They have other maybe crises of faith, but really they've literally been on that path. There are others who are raised in a Christian home that say, forget it, and go way off the rails and maybe eventually find their way back. But the crisis of faith and trying to, I don't want to say prepare your kids for a crisis of faith, but we do in a sense, because they're going to meet the world at some point. We can shelter them all we want, but at some point they are going to come face to face with the world and their enemy in the world who wants to destroy them. So how do you prepare kids for that? And I'm thinking high school, college age kids that are going to be, you know, into their more independent thinking years. You know, they're going to want to make their own decisions. They're going to be away from you if they're in college. They're going to meet people that may say direct opposite things of their parents. Right. What's your best advice for parents for that?
Well, we need to equip them with tools, which can sound intimidating. But a parent, you don't have to know the answers to equip your children. It's there is so much material out there on tools, on apologetics for teens, or answering questions that are difficult in the world that are geared towards teens. And it's so important to equip them with that, especially if they're going to go to college. College can be a dangerous place for a weak faith or a simple faith or faith period.
Yeah. You know, we are actually at the end of our day today, Amy, but we're going to talk more about that tomorrow because I feel that that is so important. And maybe there's some Christian parents out there that are really struggling with this right now, especially in today's culture and world. You know, how do we prepare our kids for this? And, you know, what are some of the things that we can do? And where do we find those tools that you talked about? And we will go into more of that tomorrow here in the Circle of Friends. And listeners, thank you so much for joining us around this table. Please come back tomorrow and join us.
This program was brought to you through the generous support of donors and listeners like you. To contact Circle of Friends Ministries, you can write to P.O. Box 345, Berlin, Ohio, 44610, or find us on Facebook at circleoffriends.fm. Program archives can be found at thelight959.com.